tonight we'll be doing some scrying, because scrying or divination work is traditional at the time of the full moon. What we'll be doing tonight is use of the pendulum to attempt to divine the sex of an unborn child. In this particular instance, it's my unborn child.
The High Priestess of this witch's coven is 16 weeks pregnant. To discover the sex of her unborn baby, Kate West is not relying on modern antenatal techniques. She is using the ancient ritual and magic of her coven.
It'll be a girl.
It's a girl.
It will be a girl.
British Isles were once pagan. Long before the first Christians walked this green and pleasant land, the religions of Albion were full of power and magic, gods and goddesses. Despite conjuring images of Satan, sacrifice and the bizarre, paganism is now claimed to be the fastest growing religion in 90s Britain. More and more people, it seems, are reaching back to ancient times and taking hold of beliefs which for some may be weird relics, but for them are living faiths.
Paganism today is a label for a group of religions which are inspired by images and ideas from the old religions, the pre-Christian religions of Europe. They're the religions rooted to the land, farthest back in our traditions. Modern paganism is also divided into several traditions, of which the most important are pagan witchcraft, particularly the high ritual witchcraft known as Wicca, druidry, shamanism, and the northern traditions, that's those who turn to Viking or Anglo-Saxon deities. The idea of modern pagan witchcraft is to try and blend religion and magic, and to re-enchant places, people, objects, to make the world more sacred, to make people more powerful.
I call on Earth to bind my spell, air to speed its travel well, bright as fire does it glow.
In winter moonlight, the coven of the Hearth of Hecate meet to perform rituals and magic at an esbat, a witch's full moon celebration.
Blessed be.
Blessed be. Most of the coven will be there. There are one or two, for one reason or another, who won't be able to make it. The way the roles are divided out is that Steve and myself are the High Priest, High Priestess, and we will have people calling the quarters, that's earth, air, fire and water.
I do summon and invoke thee, O element of air, to watch over, guard and protect us during these our rites. Blessed be.
Blessed be.
Almighty ones of the south, notice Lord of Fire.
The elements are representing parts of our physical and spiritual personalities. Air representing our thoughts, fire, passions, water, our emotions, and earth, the physical body.
O element of earth, to be with us this evening, to guide us, to watch over and protect us during these our rites. Blessed be.
Blessed be.
I call upon the goddess and the god.
Kate and Steve's priestly partnership carries over into their life together. As well as looking forward to the birth of their firstborn, they are soon to be joined in a pagan marriage, a hand fasting.
Blessed be.
Blessed be.
Both events will be marked by the coven.
Darksome night and shining moon, east then south then west then north, hearken to the witch's rune.
We tend to work robed, because use of a black robe in the forest means it's very easy to disappear when come upon by strangers. And so this is where the legends come from of witches turning themselves invisible in the woods.
I cast this sacred circle as a place of protection.
The circle separates us from this time and this space and gives us a space between the worlds in which we work. And this is, in effect, our church.
A place where everyone
and witness these outright.
The purpose of casting a circle is to allow the main event to take place, which people would describe as doing magic.
Let's just say.
Certainly doesn't mean the Paul Daniels conjuring tricks, rabbit from hats kind of magic. It means something about the use of the energy of the place and the people who meet. Just as the electricity generating boards harness the electricity from the windmill, say. So the purpose of the energy raised within the circle of people is to help other people.
Definitely a boy.
There's absolutely no doubt about that. It's definitely a girl.
The high priest may be convinced he'll have a daughter, but the coven's magic was not unanimous. They finally concluded by a count of 7-2 that their high priestess's child, to be born in 5 months' time, will be a girl. Witches operate by the light of the moon, but when the sun is shining, it's the druids who come out to play. In the first warm light of spring, Damh Smith, a member of the British Druid Order, visits his holy space. His means of worship is his music and his harp.
You've only got to listen to it, and it speaks to you when the wind blows through the strings and it plays on its own with the air. It just completely blows my mind. And to take it into a woods and just sit there within the forest, maybe beside a stream or a stone or whatever, leaning against a tree, and just playing that instrument. The old races of this earth gave human beings the harp, and whenever we play the harp, they listen.
Divided into individual paths, all pagans are bound together by a universal idea. Many religions claim a respect of nature, but for pagans, the planet's patterns and rhythms are the very bedrock of belief. For believers, this wheel of the year spins through the life of the land, the living, the dead, and the divine.
One aspect of modern paganism's very close relationship with nature is a common system of 8 festivals which are bonded to the turning wheel of the year, which mark not just the way in which the countryside, the natural world, the daylight, the climate change, but the way in which human beings change with them.
The way that most, but not all, pagans celebrate the year begins with the festival called Samhain, known as Halloween by other people, on November the 1st and its eve. A celebration of the ancestors and the recently dead. The year moves on to midwinter, to the winter solstice, longest night, shortest day, a time of cold and darkness. The wheel turns and we come to the beginning of spring, known as Imbolc. Although it's still cold and dark, there's more light and the spring is coming. The wheel turns and we come to the end of spring, the beginning of summer, or Mayday, often known as Beltane, People want to come out and celebrate. Meet your lover, go off into the woods and celebrate vitality. The commitment that you make to one another in that event at Beltane and Mayday is even more strongly expressed at the height of summer, the summer solstice, celebration of life and of summer. The wheel turns and summer moves into autumn, so the first festival of autumn, known by some pagans as Lammas, the first grain is harvested, that celebration of the gifts of the earth. The wheel turns its complete circle and we arrive back again where we started, at Samhain.
Many of the pagan paths are blessed with more than one god, but the largest pantheon of all belongs to the Odinists. Odinists worship gods more often associated with rape and pillage, the gods of Viking and Saxon invaders. So numerous are these Norse and Germanic deities that they are divided into two groups, the Æsir, the divine ancestors, and the Vanir, the gods of the land. But chief among them all is Odin.
Talking of Odin, Odin the man who took on that name, we even know this man, his name was Ziggy Fridolfsson. Now, what this man did, he was a shaman character. He sacrificed himself. He hung in a windswept tree for 9 days and nine nights, almost to the point of death, without food or drink. He looked down as he was about to die and perceived the runes, took up the runes. This is how the legends go.
It can be traced back to the what are now called the Germanic peoples of North Europe. Obviously, in the various folk wanderings, invasions, of the various lands, Great Britain, obviously England, it came with them. It came with these people who are our ancestors, and we are them. We're of their flesh, we're of their bone, we're of their spirit.
We have come again in honour and love of our gods. We ask them to be with us. We have come again in honour and respect for those who dwell here, the sprites, the urgeists, the landwights, the earth itself, we ask these to draw with us.
I think respect is one of the key words for being an Odinist. Respect the needs of people, respect the needs of the land, and it puts a sort of balance, and that's what our life is all about.
Respect for the elder folk, respect for children. I'm quite envious of the culture in some other countries that haven't lost that respect for the elder folk and for the kids. Mm. We need to get our people back on track.
And with the land. The land is very important.
Our attitude is very similar to the Native American attitude.
Yeah, it is.
That you cannot own this wonderful world outside. You cannot own parts of the landscape. But we are part of it. We must relate to it and be in harmony with it.
The modern city seems far from this harmonious pagan ideal. Shaman are for pagans the human envoys to the spirit world, but they can be found in the most mundane of neighborhoods.
The shaman works as a bridge between human worlds and other worlds, the spirit worlds. That bridge can work in various ways, and the way it works depends very much on the individual rather than on a specific role. So some of us are healers, some of us are social workers, for want of a better phrase. We're always working as that bridge, as that reaching out from human worlds to spirit worlds. I'm back again. everyone meets the spirit world. I think most people will have walked into a house and felt it as a friendly space or an unfriendly space. And for us, that's the spiritual process, because that's a recognition of spirit, of an awareness that says home's important and home grows and changes as something greater than just me, that I contribute to it, but there's factors there that are independent of what I do.
Shamans are solitary figures. To commune with the spirits, Gordon the Toad works alone, but he can use a number of tools to help him.
Shamans work with trance, a time when they are aware of both the physical world and the other world, the spirit world. Getting there takes different paths depending on the people, and we all work in slightly different ways. Some people use music, some people dance, some people use drugs, some cultures use pain, and if, like me, you're a dancer, you use dance as the vehicle that takes you from one world into another. Here now, I'm very physical, but every step I take here on this earth, I'm also stepping on the other world, into a spirit world. As I dance, the heart becomes more and more still, so it's like a whirlwind, and the more movement there is, the pool in the center stays calm and becomes calmer. When you find that balance, when you find the stillness, you hit ecstasy. You hit the point when the world opens up and nothing else is ever quite the same again.
The wheel of the year has turned to the 1st of May and the Festival of Beltane. At the Long Man of Wilmington in East Sussex, Damh Smith and other members of the British Druid Order pick their way through the Ramblers to celebrate the prospect of summer.
The only path I would have found would be one that gave me freedom of will, and that allowed me to worship outside. The things that speak to me are the rivers and springs and the mountains and hills and valleys, blah, blah, blah. Not human beings, not go-betweens. And other than paganism, I can't think of anything else that gives me that freedom.
For pagans, the Festival of Beltane marks the mythological marriage of the goddess and the god. For this reason, it has become a traditional time for mortals to get married too. This Beltane has been chosen by Kate West and Steve Payne for their hand fasting.
One of the things about hand fasting that differs quite widely from the wedding ceremonies reflected in other religions is that the people who join have a choice of three options. They can choose to join for a year and a day, or they can choose to join for a lifetime, or they can choose to make a karmic link, which in theory is for eternity. In Kate and my case, I think, well, I shouldn't really say, but we have decided to make the karmic link. I do offer you all that I am, body, mind and soul. In bright days and dark days, in good times and bad. As the wheel turns ever on, we shall mark the time of the seasons together. May the spirit of our love know no boundaries. Life after life, time after time. From this day forth, so mote it be.
Beloved, to me you are the sun, Lord of fire and light, whose presence breathes hope and life unto the land. You are the Lord of darkness, who opens the ways to light. You are my light and dark, day and night, life and death. I embrace you and take you to my hand, at the setting of the sun and at the rising of the stars, in this life and in those to come. As I do will, so mote it be. Thus it be.
Thus it be.
So they gathered from the forest, from the grove where they meet, flowers of oak, broom and meadow sweet.
I used to go to Sunday school when I was a child, and I remember one particular time I came out talking about palm trees and how they'd laid down the palm trees for Jesus to come along. And I walked out and it was winter, and it was freezing cold, and I hadn't seen a palm tree. And I just couldn't relate to this because it just didn't feel as if it was part of the land that I lived on.
Flower face is your name, blood I wear, you carry life within your breath. Call the May, call the May, call the May, call the May.
I was in a band for many years. We were going to be mega, huge rock stars, but it didn't happen. And I was left a sad old hippie playing my guitar upstairs in my bedroom on my own. Then I discovered a spiritual tradition that held this performance aspect along with a deep-rooted respect for the island that I live on, and a druid was born.
These lights represent the bellfires of old, between which all would pass for fertility. Likewise, the brim represents the unity of the male and female, and the jump from one life to another.
He doesn't want to jump into this life, does he?
Yay! Kate and Steve have made their vows before their god and goddess, but the local registry office will have to wait. In paganism, unlike some more established religions, men and women share in all things, including divine status.
We've got used to the idea that a god is male. God is Father, and therefore it comes as a bit of a shock or surprise to people when they discover that pagans more often refer to deity as goddess.
The concept of goddess or goddesses, as well as gods, is absolutely crucial to paganism, and it produces some remarkable results for modern people turning to a pagan religion.
The goddess isn't always nice. She doesn't always manifest a maternal side. There are plenty of goddesses who are fairly unpleasant. You wouldn't invite them around for tea. They don't want to nurture you. They want to give you a kick at the backside and tell you get on with living a decent life in the world.
To a lot of women, the idea of a goddess is something that's self-liberating. It frees the goddess inside each woman who wishes to respond in that way. It makes women more powerful.
For men, finding that the divine is female can be a bit of a shock and a bit of a threat. Here we are finding that the divine is not like ourselves, and that we therefore are not given ultimate authority to be macho warriors. We are told that there are other ways of living.
Having foretold of the sex of their infant, the high priest and high priestess of the hearth of Hecate prepare for parenthood, but they're still not absolutely sure whether to buy pink or blue.
Yes. I think we're both looking forward to the baby arriving, although I can't say I'm in any great hurry for the pregnancy to be over. It'd be quite nice to enjoy being pregnant for a bit before moving on to having a little person around. There you go, it's completely slugs and snails to start with.
Well, it's a nice natural motif.
Where's the mud?
Which one?
We'll have this one.
Dave Smith and his wife Karina are well versed in family life.
It's got a donut in it, that's nice.
It's got an old donut in it, lovely. Okay.
We consider ourselves as ordinary people. We're not weirdos, we're ordinary people. We have to deal with ordinary, everyday things.
Shall we go and get some apples then? Or what about some bananas?
Dave's had chicken pox recently, then passed it on to the boys. I've had all the males in my family with chicken pox.
Three? That's it, look.
I didn't go out and use this, that and the other from the garden. I went to the chemist and I bought the antihistamines, the anti-scratch stuff, the cotton wool balls, to make everybody comfortable.
You're a bit noisy, actually, aren't you?
They have a normal life, but what is normal as well? What we give them is a life that is nurtured, where they are cared for. We try our very best not to put them in danger. They're fed, they're watered, they're educated, they're loved lots, and that's what normal people should do, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
About that? Would you like that? The circus sticker book.
What is it?
I think the boys will become aware that their parents aren't Christian.
Or Jewish.
Or Jewish
Hindu,
or any other
or Muslim,
religion.
We are pagan.
But the thing is, the boys, our boys, will make their own decisions about their own path when they are old enough and they want to do it. They are merely children of pagan parents. And we will bring them up, we will take them to the woods, we will get them to identify trees, we will teach them about the turning of the seasons, you know, all the natural things that any little boys should really know.
The circus one.
All right, put the other one back then.
Is that the one that you want?
Yeah. What do you
Pardon?
Say?
Magic words. Please, that's better.
In terms of bringing up the child, there will be a lot of Wiccan influence around, obviously, because we are high priest and high priestess of a coven. That is part of day-to-day life. But as Wiccans, we believe in religious tolerance and people making up their own mind, and that applies to our child as much so. That is the essence of Wicca.
A lot of the path is about self-development and self-responsibility and personal responsibility, and that is, you can't say the devil made me do it. It's not a question of there being outside forces that influence you to do good or bad. It's very much about examining your own motives and making sure that what you do is right for you and right for the world and the society in which you live. The overriding rule, which is the Wiccan reed, is an it harm none, do what you will. And that none goes out towards the community you live in and the world you live in, but also turns back inwards on yourself and means doing no harm to yourself as well and to the planet that you live with.
So you hold my hand, please. No, no more whining and stop.
No. You are going to have to behave yourself. Or you're going to go to bed with no story and no tea. Okay? Now, you listen. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Right, now be a good boy now for Daddy, okay?
No,
you hold on to the side, okay?
The way we sort of manage children, we talk a lot to other pagan people. And like any, I mean, I'm going to put the women side here, like any women, we sit down and we talk, what are we going to do about so-and-so? What do we do about so-and-so? Like people do.
Mm. It's a community.
Yeah.
It is a community.
You talk to each other about what's going on.
But there is no ultimate book of right and wrong within paganism. It's common sense and family values, yeah. Believe it or not, you know.
Ready? Oh, jump! Oh.
Yay!
Yeah.
A religion's not a system of morality. It's not there to police people. It's not simply there to deal with matters of sin or of conscience or of good or bad behaviour. We have all sorts of systems that do that. They're called philosophies, they're called moralities, they're called laws.
We stand this sacred site, this English hill.
Paganism, like other religions, has its own forms of dark fundamentalism.
Again, we re-hallow England to holiness and goodness and life.
For Odinists, there is a thin line to tread between their religious views about culture and race and the political prejudice of the far right.
To my comrades of the Middlesex Regiment, we're coming up to our regimental day on the 16th of this month. Die hard!
We are proud of our race and our folk. We expect others to be proud of their race and their folk. So, when a guy walks down the street wearing I can't think of the name for a second, the Jewish cap, good luck to him. Or a chap in African robes, or a Muslim, or whatever, good luck to him. He's proud of his race and faith and folk, exactly the same as we are.
Well, ye Woden, my apple land, my noble land, was hal.
Our ethical code, if you like, is each to his or her own. But it seems to be somewhat of a, almost like a sin to be proud of being English. It seems to be a sin to be proud of who you are, to be proud of our culture, of our heritage, of our arts, of the things that make us unique.
Zigtia! Zigtia! Zigtia!
Paganism is a spirituality like any other, so it has its shadow side. It has its bits which upset some people within the movement, let alone outside of it, that there are pagans, for example, who are very angry about Christianity, and some of them are very militantly aggressive about their views of Christianity, their hostility to it. And you may think there are good reasons for that, you may not, but okay, that's part of the spirituality of the religion growing up and taking its place among the religions of the world.
But the old images are very powerful. Outdated concepts of animal or human sacrifice, of sexual orgies, of using magic to gain power over other people and make them serve you. You know, these are part of our fairy tales. And although modern paganism has nothing very much to do with all this at all, the fairy tales won't go away.
The links between paganism, witchcraft, Satanism goes back to the earlier days of the church. The church was and is a socio-political organisation, and when making a takeover bid for somebody else's religion, the easiest way to do it is to make the other guy's gods into devils, the other guy's good gods into bad, wicked things. And that's where your link comes with devil worship. They turned our horned god into Satan. Now, Wiccans don't believe in Satan. Satan, the devil, is a Christian invention.
Three 3:30 in the morning, June the 21st, summer solstice. A day now famous for the annual attempt by Druids to gain access to the ancient and holy site of Stonehenge.
Sun rising soon.
A long history of conflict with revelers has led the police to exclude everyone from the site on this day.
They've made it pretty clear that any attempt we make to go towards Stonehenge, they will regard as an attempt to hold the trespassery assembly. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
All right. First thing, obviously, we wanted to ask, is it going to be possible to go up to Stonehenge?
No.
No.
No, it's
not. Pagans have to balance their need to worship with a desire to live in harmony with a society that prefers to keep what it views with suspicion safely at arm's length.
Great.
Have a nice time.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Cheers.
Happy solstice.
Happy solstice. Happy
solstice. With a few short minutes before sunrise, the Wiltshire Constabulary helped the Druids find an alternative stone circle. The roundabout, at the junction of the A345 and the A303, a mile from Stonehenge.
O ancient power of the sun, in thine ancient names, Michael, Balin, Arthur, Lou, Hearn, we call upon thee. Lift up thy shining spear of light to defend us. Bring us ripening cornfields, blossoming orchards. Put to flight the powers of darkness. And bring us to stand upon thy hill of vision and show us the lovely realms of the god.
Hi there. Hello. Is that a beautiful sunrise? We brought you some flowers.
That's very kind. Thank you very much.
27 there, one from each of us. And thank you so much for letting us come this close. It's really appreciated.
It's no problem.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much.
Let's see beer. Happy solstice.
And yourself.
Thank you. Bye.
These are real religions. They're quite complex ways of looking at the divine. They're not cults because they don't venerate a single object or person or deity. They're not temporary structures that vanish as soon as a single charismatic leader vanishes. They're traditions that are here to stay.
September, and Kate, the High Priestess, has safely given birth, a precious event for her and her partner Steve. But the gods have ways of playing tricks, and the magic of birth contradicts the magical prophecy of the coven. The child is not a girl.
So here we are, on the 6th of September. I'm having my arms. The beautiful baby boy. Weighing in at 7 pounds 8 ounces. Whose name is going to be Taliesin Keith Newton. Child of a pair of witches.
I sister Sati Diana, Hecate Demeter Kali Inanna. I sister Sati Diana, Hecate Demeter Kali Inanna. I sister Sati Diana, Hecate Demeter Kali Inanna. Hecate Demeter Kali Inanna. I sister Sati Diana, Hecate Demeter Kali Inanna.